Welcome. This is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is Exploration. Every week on Exploration, we discuss the fascinating world of science and its impact on society. And today, leading off, we're going to summarize some of the top stories in science. The lead story, once again, concerns the third wave. We are entering in a big way the third wave of the coronavirus pandemic, which is even bigger than the first wave that we had back in March. The first wave was largely driven by the infections in the elderly. But the third wave is being driven by a combination. Young people, people that are sick and tired of being perpetually locked down, lockdown fever. That seems to be what's driving the third wave. But there's also more science behind the coronavirus. First of all, scientists have researched masks, social separation, washing your hands, don't touch your face. And the question is, which is best? Which is most effective? Because not everything is effective against the virus. So what is the research? What does the research say about this? And second of all, I get emails. People ask me, well, smarty pants, what about you? What kinds of changes have you made personally in your behavior because of the coronavirus? So I'll say a few things about my personal perspective on the virus. And then the Chinese. The Chinese are back to the moon, and they want to bring back moon rock. Yes, rock retrieval is now the agenda of the Chinese space program. And the question is, how does it compare with the U.S. space program? What does it all mean? Where is it all going? And also, SpaceX, the company founded by Elon Musk, is constantly making headlines. This time, once again, they sent another batch of mini satellites into orbit with the goal of one day having a world-spanning network of thousands of internet satellites, giving instantaneous internet access to anyone on the planet Earth. That's the goal, to make the internet a human right, a universal human right. But of course, there are critics of that. First of all, we have dictators who don't like the fact that their subjects, who are traditionally deprived of information, are being information about how to organize against these dictatorships. And also, astronomers. Astronomers have second doubts about a world-spanning network of thousands of internet satellites interfering with the science of astronomy. And speaking about science, a new science is being born right in front of us, and that is the biotechnology of pets and domesticated animals. So scientists are now asking simple questions for which everybody has an answer, actually. First of all, why do cats meow? I mean, wild cats don't meow at all. So why do domesticated cats meow? And why are there so many breeds of dogs compared to cats? There are not that many breeds of cats, but there are many breeds of dogs that you can just rattle the names off. And the question is why? And animal intelligence, how smart are the animals anyway? Well, let's just jump right into some of the top stories of the past week. Our lead story once again concerns the third wave, a wave bigger than the first wave of the coronavirus that we had back in March. This time is driven by people who are young, perhaps a little bit foolhardy, but some people who are just downright sick and tired of watching the economy tank and their paycheck evaporate because of the lockdown and all the social measures being taken against the virus. So scientists are now beginning to analyze which is the best method. If you had to choose between some of the methods that are being proposed, which ones are the most effective and why? Well, researchers at Simon Fraser University have analyzed each of these precautions separately and have analyzed them, like masks, social separation, washing hands, don't touch your face. So the question is, which is the most effective and why? Well, what they found was rather interesting. They found that by far the most effective way to stem the pandemic is to maintain social separation. That's right, social separate, even more than masks. Now, why is that? Because how does the virus spread? Yes, it can spread by touching things, but the virus does die of its own when it's exposed to the air. It requires humans. It requires humans to incubate and reproduce. And if you separate humans, the rate of contact between them and the rate at which the virus spreads between humans drops dramatically. So social separation, of all the methods being looked at, is by far the most effective way to deal with the virus. So what does that mean for you? These scientists have also analyzed what is the worst possible place you can be in a pandemic. And they say, hands down, the worst places you could be is church weddings, funerals, bars, intimate dinner parties. In other words, areas where you are in close contact with people for more than 15 minutes, people who may laugh loudly, speak, chant, sing, and you may be with these people for hours at a time in very close quarters. Now, all of us exist in a social bubble of, let's say, ourselves, our spouse, men, maybe our children. We know that we do not have the virus because we talk to each other all the time. But when we bump into other social bubbles, especially in crowded, indoor, noisy environments, that is by far the greatest place that the virus can be spread. And of course, as we head into the winter holiday season, the number of infections could in fact explode as a consequence. Now, there are other factors that are involved, of course, and that is wearing masks. But you see, wearing masks, sometimes people have dirty masks. Air sometimes seeps into the side of the mask. So wearing masks is a good thing. I wear a mask when I go outside, but it's not as good as maintaining social distances between people. And also, this report recommends that you stay away from certain areas where there are potentially lots of people, for example, the mass transit system, the airlines, sports games, people that can congregate in large numbers, yell, scream, shout, what have you. That's also an environment that you should watch out for. And then I get some personal questions on the email too. Some people say, well, what about you, Professor? What kinds of sacrifices, what kinds of changes have you made personally in your environment? Well, let me list them simply. First is I got tested. Yes, in New York City, there are quite a few testing centers, and in about 2 days, you'll get a response after they use PCR, polymerase chain reaction methodology, to grow the virus. Well, I tested negative, and I highly recommend that everybody out there get tested, in fact, regularly, because even if you get tested once, you still can get infected later. Next, of course, wear a mask, avoid crowded gatherings, avoid talking to people in indoor environments for more than about 15 minutes or so. Yes, all the methods I mentioned earlier. Next, I bought an oximeter. An oximeter only costs $50, and it could save your life because it tells you how much your oxygen level is dropping in your blood. Normally, an oximeter would say that your blood level is 98% to 99% oxygenated, but if you have the virus, it starts to drop to 95, 90, 85, 80. When you're down to 80, you're actually near death. Now, it turns out that people compensate. They breathe harder, and therefore they think that there's no problem, and they don't go to the hospital. Wrong. By the time you're down to 80, you're very close to death, even if you feel reasonably okay. What do you do when your oximeter says that you're down to 85 or 80? Go to the hospital, ASAP. Anyway, the oximeter is available on the web, only costs about $50. Next, my cell phone. My cell phone, it has an app that I recently downloaded from the state of New York. And that is, it alerts you when you've been too close to somebody who's tested positive for the virus if you've been in their vicinity for 10 minutes. Now, how does that work? When someone tests positive for the virus, Many times these people then report it. It's logged with the state of New York that puts that telephone number on a database. So when your cell phone is in contact with this person's cell phone and you're in contact for more than 10 minutes, they'll give you an alert. An alert that says that you are in the presence of someone who's tested positive for the coronavirus. So I downloaded it, and I highly recommend that you also download this early warning system. And what about transportation? Yes, the subways are great in New York. However, I'm a little bit hesitant to use public transportation because of the fact that the air you breathe, things you touch, have been touched and breathed upon by thousands, hundreds of thousands of other people. So if possible, not everyone can do this, but if possible, take a taxi or take a car ride and roll down the windows and afterwards use a hand sanitizer. And then if you have to go outside, well, go to the supermarket, go to the drugstore, preferably early in the morning when there's not that many people there. Obey social distancing and don't stay too long indoors in a supermarket or drugstore. And what about recreation? Yes, it's great to go to restaurants, but again, the problem is you're bumping into other social bubbles. You trust your social bubble. You've lived with these people for months. You know that the people inside your bubble are virus-free. But if you're in a restaurant that's not ventilated well, where there's lots of people, let's say at lunchtime or dinner time, you can bump into other bubbles where people may not have been so vigilant against the virus. And then the next question I get is, well, will I get vaccinated? And the answer is yes. As soon as it's available, I will try to get vaccinated. And the question is, well, how effective is the vaccine? Well, they say it's 90% plus effective, but what does that mean? That means if you take a group of people that have been vaccinated, compare them with a group that only got a placebo, then 90% of the new viral cases are in the group that was not vaccinated. So how long does this immunity last? Well, we're not sure. The latest study just came out this week. 6 months, greater than 6 months, is the minimum time frame for someone who's already been infected with the virus and recovered. The vaccine is better than that, they say. And so we can say that the first estimate is you'll be free of the virus at least for 6 months, if not more. But do we know for sure? And the answer is no, because the virus has only been tested on large populations for the last 2 months. And can you mix these shots? Some of these shots require a booster. You have to go back after a month. And of course, after that, maybe after a year, you may have to go back again. Can you mix these? And the answer is probably not. Okay, better to stick with one. And right now, not one, not two, but three. Three companies are offering the vaccine starting in December. And then another question is, what about the after effects? Well, that's the weak spot in this whole thing. The vaccine has been tested. It's been tested on thousands of people. It's been remarkably effective, but it's only been for the last 2 months. Side effects that don't show up until after 2 months, well, we simply don't know what they are. So far, the after effects that we have found are mild. You get a sore spot, you feel have slight fever perhaps, feel tired, but that's about it. Then the next question is, well, what about next year? What's going to happen next year? Well, next year, by April, May, perhaps everybody in the United States that wants to get vaccinated will get vaccinated for free. But does that mean that we can throw away the mask, throw away all the social separation? And the answer is no. Because it means that the virus is still circulating there. And if your immunity expires for some reason, you are still susceptible to the virus. So what does that mean for our life in 2021? Well, it means that we're still going to have to continue wearing masks and obeying social distancing because we have not yet achieved herd immunity. Herd immunity is when perhaps 60 to 70% or so of a population has gotten the virus and recovered from it or got vaccinated for it. And so the virus has very little wiggle room to infect the next generation of individuals. However, two things. First, we don't know exactly where herd immunity starts and begins with regards to the coronavirus. That's a big unknown. And it means that if we do not yet achieve full herd immunity, because some people don't want to get vaccinated, it means that the virus will still circulate, even if you've been vaccinated. And so when your immunity runs out, you are once again vulnerable. Vulnerable because other individuals refuse to be vaccinated, thereby making herd immunity a difficult goal to attain. So what's the solution to the problem? Well, the solution to the problem, of course, is to encourage people to get vaccinated, assuming, of course, that there are no bad side effects to the vaccine. But until we hit herd immunity, either by natural infection or by vaccination, until that happens, we're still vulnerable because the virus is still circulating, because there's still targets to infect and spread the virus. And so that's another reason for believing that a vaccine could be one of the key features of preventing the pandemic from spreading more than it has already. Well, now I'd like to leave the world of inner space and go into outer space. The Chinese have sent yet another probe to the moon, this time with the explicit instructions to get rock retrieval. You know, back in the days of the Apollo space program 50 years ago, our astronauts brought back over 800 pounds of moon rocks. Well, the Chinese are now following in the footsteps of the Russian and American space program, step by step, very methodically, step by step, reproducing all the steps that we took 30 to 50 years ago. And they hope to attain rock retrieval of perhaps 10 pounds of moon rockets by remote control. And then the question is, well, how does that then compare with what the United States did back in the days of the Apollo? This means that the Chinese are still roughly 30, 40 years behind the United States and Russia in terms of space travel, but they are leaping ahead, leaps and bounds, by skipping a few steps. For example, they sent a probe to Mars recently. It should reach the red planet early next year in 2021, if all goes well. It is a three-in-one shot. You see, for the United States, we had a Mars program that first put an orbiter around Mars. Second, another probe landed on Mars, the Viking. And then third, another probe then released a rover on the surface of Mars. So it was a three-pronged program. First, an orbiter, then a lander, and then a rover. Well, the Chinese want to cut this down into one shot, a three-in-one shot, and their latest Mars shot launched a few months ago, which will reach Mars early in 2021, has all three. It has an orbiter, a lander, and a rover all in one. So they hope to basically leapfrog into the future. And then some people in the media are saying, well, is that dangerous? Does that mean that we have a new space race coming around the corner? Well, a space race and a space war would be one of the worst things that could happen to the United States because, first of all, who's most vulnerable? We are. Over 50% of the satellites in outer space are connected to the U.S. economy. We would be blinded. It would be a body blow to the U.S. economy if a war were to break out in outer space. And remember that our satellites are not shielded. They're not protected. Our satellites are sitting ducks to a preemptive strike. The meaning, therefore, is that we should sign a revised version of the Outer Space Treaty of 1967. Hard to believe, but this ancient document, the Outer Space Treaty of 1967, actually held the peace. The Outer Space Treaty simply says that the nations of the world should not detonate nuclear weapons or test them in outer space. And second of all, they should not claim celestial bodies as their national property. That was a very modest set of goals, but it held the peace for so many decades. But it has to be revised. Now, of course, we have non-nuclear weapons that could easily blind, destroy, mutilate enemy satellites in a preemptive first strike. And it means that, yes, we should negotiate so that there is a peaceful exploration of outer space rather than a weaponization of outer space, because in a war, we stand to be the big loser. You know, the Chinese have an expression, never pick up a rock, only to drop it on your own feet. That is, never reach for space weapons when the enemy could also reach for space weapons. And then if a war breaks out, who suffers the most? We suffer the most, because most of the satellites are our satellites. We would be blinded. The internet would go down. Telecommunications would become useless. The military would push all the buttons it can, but it can't activate anybody outside of Washington because all communication satellites are down. And in case of an electromagnetic pulse, a rogue nation, even a small nation like North Korea, could detonate a nuclear weapon in outer space and paralyze communications in this country. So in other words, a space war is one thing we do not want. And speaking about outer space, Elon Musk is fulfilling yet another goal, and that is to have a universal internet network linking outer space with the average person anywhere, anytime. In other words, in the future, internet access could become a universal human right. Now, that could be a tremendous step forward toward empowering the powerless. If you live under a dictatorship, the dictator controls all the information that comes to you. You don't know how to organize. You don't know how to revolt. You can't do anything because you're isolated. But with universal internet access, because of thousands of satellites, mini satellites carrying the internet anywhere on the surface of the earth, this spreads knowledge. With the spreading of knowledge comes empowerment. With the spreading of empowerment comes democracy. Now, some people say that technology has no moral direction. It's like a hammer. It's like a saw. It's like a knife, a double-edged sword. It can cut with you or it can cut against you. It is ethically neutral. Well, I disagree. I think universal internet access is a positive step forward because with it comes knowledge, then empowerment, then democracy. Because people say to themselves, I don't have to live like that. I can live in a better society. I have the tools, the knowledge to organize, to create a better society. Now, of course, anything as ambitious as creating a network of thousands of Starlink satellites, that's Elon Musk's vision, is going to endanger some opposition. And yes, there's some opposition to this idea. One source of opposition comes from dictatorships who are obviously on the receiving end of this huge tank coming at them called knowledge, democracy, empowerment. They don't like that. But the other group that is critical of Starlink is the astronomers of the world. Because you see, all these satellites, thousands of them orbiting the Earth, will create pollution, light pollution, that'll obscure their telescopes. Not only that, but also debris, thousands of pieces of space debris as we begin to put the internet in outer space. Well, I'll keep you informed about the latest concerning the debate, pro and con, about Starlink. Also, on a slightly different note, let's talk about a new science that's being born, and that is the biotechnology of animals, specifically our pets. You know, veterinary science has always been sort of like a backwash to human medical science. However, with the coming of biotechnology, we realize that we're all part of the tree of life. Our genes are very similar to the genes of animals, and we're beginning to analyze them scientifically through evolution and through biotechnology. Pets, dogs and cats. First of all, it all started about 10,000 years ago with the ending of the Ice Age. At that point, humans began to domesticate animals, and two animals that were domesticated are very important. One was a social animal, an animal that hunted in tribes, packs, and that was the gray wolf. And that domesticated animal became the dog. And then we have the cat domesticated from a loner, that is the wild cat. And that's one reason why dogs are very sociable. They follow humans because they belong in a pack. We are the top dog. They are the underdog. And therefore, they think we are the masters, part of their genes. Well, cats are loners. They're wild cats. And then here's a question. Why do cats meow? Well, it turns out that wild cats do not meow at all. Adult wild cats do not communicate primarily through meows. However, kittens, that's how kittens communicate with their mother. So, in other words, when cats get domesticated, they meow as a way to communicate with their, quote, mother, unquote, that is, us. In the same way that dogs think that we are the top dog, the alpha male, cats think that we are, in some sense, the mother cat, and so they meow when they want their way. Because, of course, they are solitary hunters, they're not pack animals like dogs. And then the other question is, how come there's so many dog species, but not that many cat species? I mean, think of all the dog species there are. You can just rattle them off on your fingertip. Well, the reason is that we've been breeding cats for about 10,000 years for two purposes. One is to chase pests like mice, and the other one is for, you know, companionship. But dogs have been bred for perhaps 20,000 years, even during the middle of the Ice Age, and dogs were bred to become hunters, to become shepherders. They were bred for safety concerns, for hunting, so many different tasks that humans gave the dog. And that's why there's so many varieties of dog compared to cats. And then yet another question that comes up is, well, what about intelligence? I mean, how smart are the cats and dogs that we have in our house? Well, they're quite smart. You can teach them all sorts of tricks, except one trick that is always slightly beyond their comprehension. Teach your dog or a cat the meaning of tomorrow. That's right, the meaning of tomorrow. Something that children understand, but animals have a hard time understanding. They have a sense of time, but it's not very long because it was not really necessary in the forest. Instinct. Instinct was good enough for most animals, and so animals really never evolved to have a sense of time. Well, that concludes the first part of Exploration with Dr. Michio Kaku. In the second half, we're going to go into outer space, way into outer space, as we talk about the latest concerning the creation of the universe itself. We're going to bring on Michael Lemonick of Time Magazine, talking about the latest of what we know about the creation of everything there is, the universe itself. So stay tuned for the second half of Exploration. Welcome back to Exploration. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. And this is Exploration. You know, in the first part of Exploration, we talked about, well, some of the dreary news affecting inner space, that is, the planet Earth, with the coronavirus entering its third great wave. Well, in the second half of exploration, we're going to shift gears and talk about outer space. I mean, really way out in outer space. We're talking about the origin of the universe. In the last decade or so, so much new information has come in. First of all, verifying Einstein's theory of a Big Bang, but also clarifying it and opening up new mysteries. What is dark matter? What is dark energy? So with us today to talk about these recent discoveries is Simon Singh, a physicist and commentator for BBC Television, who'll talk to us about some of the latest developments in the Big Bang theory. You know, every culture has some kind of mythology, some kind of folklore concerning the origin of the universe. However, it's not testable. They're not verifiable. They're not falsifiable. However, the Big Bang theory is a real theory. It can be tested. We can reproduce many of the results with satellites, and it's, in principle, falsifiable. So once again, with us today is Simon Singh, BBC commentator, physicist, talking about the origin of the universe.
Dr. Singh, let me first ask you about one of the greatest paradoxes in all of cosmology, which is Olbers' paradox. Olbers' paradox says that if the universe is infinite, has no beginning, no end, and is uniform, then there should be an infinite number of stars in the sky, an infinite amount of light entering your eyeball, and therefore the sky should be on fire. The night sky should be white, not black, because everywhere you look, you're staring at an infinite number of stars. So how do we resolve this Olbers' paradox, the fact that the night sky should be white with an infinite number of stars, but actually is black?
Yes, I think it was a real problem. As you said, it's a nice piece of mathematics. You can sort of just look at shells of the universe, and every shell contains a finite number of stars, and if you build up the shells, it turns out that wherever you look, you should see a star. And therefore, the night sky, as you say, instead of being pretty much black, would be pretty much brilliant white, infinitely bright. And I think astronomers were fundamentally stumped by this. So I think you can come up with all sorts of ad hoc excuses. You know, maybe there's dust in the universe that absorbs the light. Well, then the dust should re-emit the light. Can't get rid of it. You know, people tried to come up with all sorts of excuses, but none of them were really very satisfactory. If the universe is eternal and pretty much unchanging, there's no real way out of Olbers' paradox, I think.
So it was Edgar Allan Poe, according to historians who've gone through the record, it was Edgar Allan Poe, the famous American mystery writer, who practically on his deathbed wrote the solution to Olbers' paradox. So maybe the universe had a beginning. Maybe there's a cutoff with regards to the amount of light that hits your eyeball when you look in outer space. Could you elaborate?
I didn't realize that Edgar Allan Poe had sort of come up with this first, but as you say, the way we now get out of Olbers' paradox is with the Big Bang theory. The Big Bang theory says the universe hasn't been here forever. It's only been here for a finite time. We now know that's roughly 14 billion years. The best guess we have is 13.7 billion years. If the universe has only been here for a finite amount of time, then light can have reached us only from a finite volume of the universe. So out there, way, way, way beyond this kind of horizon, there may be tons and tons of light, but none of it's reached us yet because it's too far away. So we effectively live in a sort of a finite volume of observation, and therefore we only see a finite amount of light. And I think that's how we get out of Olbers' paradox today. In other words, you have to abandon the idea of an eternal, infinite universe and embrace the idea of a universe with a finite age. It was actually created a finite time ago.
So it's rather amazing that the reason why the night sky is black is because there is a cutoff, as Edgar Allan Poe mentioned in his book. There's a cutoff. Light hasn't had time to reach us because there was a beginning. Now, the Hubble Space Telescope has actually given us photographs of the most distant stars in the universe. And sure enough, when you go past the most distant stars, there is blackness.
there is essentially the Big Bang. The Big Bang is essentially staring at you in the face. And of course, the Big Bang you cannot see because it's in the microwave region. But that's the reason why the night sky is black, because you're literally staring at the Big Bang.
Yeah, it's very interesting that if we go back 100 years, Einstein was sort of his 100th anniversary of his Annus Mirabilis. If we go back to 1905, pretty much the whole scientific establishment thinks that the universe has been here forever. They don't believe in the Big Bang. And yet, in a way, the clue was there. Olber's paradox is what should have been telling them that they have to really move towards a Big Bang model. And Edgar Allan Poe, that's interesting to know that he sort of first posited this. One of the first people to sort of posit it in a more mathematical framework was the Belgian cosmologist Georges Lemaître in around 1927. And he sat down and wrote down the equations and said, look, logically, it is possible. If we look at Einstein's theory of gravitation, everything is consistent with the idea of a Big Bang universe. He didn't talk about a Big Bang. He used phrases like a day without a yesterday. But essentially, he was solving Olber's paradox by saying the universe started with a Big Bang. Still, nobody believed him, though. Still, the scientific establishment wanted to hold on to its notion of an eternal universe. Like every establishment, people are sort of comfortable with what they know, and they're reluctant to embrace new ideas, especially as there wasn't really much observational evidence to back up Lemaître's idea. So the Big Bang in the mid-1920s was very much a hypothesis.
Okay, now let's go to the late 1920s, where we have Edwin Hubble, who is perhaps the greatest astronomer of the last century, where we have the discovery of the expanding universe from Mount Wilson Observatory in California. So could you elaborate now, what did Edwin Hubble find?
Well, Hubble looked up into the night sky and studied galaxies and was measuring what we call redshift. If you listen to a car go by at high speed, it makes that classic noise, it goes from a high pitch to a low pitch. As it approaches, the sound waves are sort of compressed. As it leaves, the sound waves are drawn apart. Now, if a galaxy is approaching, it doesn't make a sound, but the light waves are sort of compressed. The physics is a bit more complicated than this, but essentially, if a galaxy is coming towards you, it should look a little bit blue. If it's moving away from you, it should look a little bit red. Now, whenever Hubble looked at a distant galaxy, it was always red. It was always red-shifted, always redder than it should have been. So if all the galaxies in the universe, all the distant galaxies, if they're all red-shifted, they're all moving away. If they're all moving away, well, that's exactly what you would expect if the universe started with a Big Bang. Hot, dense, compact object explodes outwards. The debris forms galaxies. The galaxies should still be flying apart. And that's exactly what Hubble was seeing. So this is sort of 1929 to 1931, when this data sort of started rolling in. It was the first real evidence to sort of indicate that maybe Lemaître was right. Still, the scientific establishment didn't embrace the Big Bang theory. It's like building a case in a court of law. You don't convict somebody on maybe just one piece of evidence. If the Big Bang is guilty of creating the universe, we want more than just one piece of evidence. So Lemaître and the other supporters of the Big Bang theory had to continue their battle to find proof of the Big Bang. But Hubble's data, you're absolutely right, was pivotal in beginning to swing the debate in their favor.
Okay, now let's go to the 1950s when a British astronomer and his colleagues, led by Fred Hoyle, begin to challenge the Big Bang theory. And apparently, in a BBC debate with George Gamow, Fred Hoyle coins the word Big Bang as a rather derisive comment. After all, it wasn't very big, and there was no bang. But tell us a little bit about the debate between Fred Hoyle and George Gamow.
Well, yeah, I think Gamow was a proponent of the Big Bang theory, whereas Hoyle was very skeptical. And I've heard this BBC Radio piece of archive, and it's lovely to hear Fred Hoyle in his very kind of Yorkshire, abrupt, down-to-earth voice saying, this Big Bang theory to me seems unreasonable. And he used the phrase as an insult. Big Bang, just kind of a throwaway comment. But the name stuck. And critics liked it, the fans liked it, and we've sort of used it ever since. But the reason that Hoyle found Big Bang to be unreasonable was he just found it, I think, philosophically unpalatable to have a creation. He didn't like the idea of a moment of creation. To me, it sort of smacked, to him, it sort of smacked of a god. On the other hand, he had to accept that the universe was expanding. The universe was getting bigger. So how do you marry those two things? The universe that is changing, but on the other hand, Hoyle wanted it to last forever and to have been here forever. And his way to sort of marry those two ideas was to say, okay, the galaxies move apart because the universe is expanding. But then new matter is created in the gaps. And that new matter evolves into galaxies. And then that galaxy moves away, and then a new galaxy is born. And so that way, the overall density of galaxies in the universe remains the same. If you look way into the future, the overall galaxies remain equally dense. If you look way into the past, the number of galaxies per certain volume remains the same. And this was called the steady state theory of the universe. My understanding was I met Thomas Gold, who worked with Fred Hoyle on this, and he told me a story that they went to see a film in 1945. And the film is about a young man who wakes up one morning. He's had been having a huge dream, a very vivid dream. In the middle of the dream, he suddenly wakes up. He gets washed. He gets dressed. He jumps into his car. He drives into the countryside. His car breaks down. He goes into a house looking for help. Things go horribly wrong. It's a sort of slightly drawn-out story, but things go horribly wrong. And eventually, the people in the house grab the young man and strangle him. They throttle him. And just as they're about to strangle him to death, he wakes up. He's been having a dream. He gets washed. He gets dressed. He jumps into his car. He drives into the countryside. His car breaks down. He goes to a house. He looks for help. And so on and so on. So here's a film that has a sort of cyclic or continual version. The film could go on forever and ever and ever. It sort of develops, but it sort of stays the same. And it was seeing that film that inspired Fred Hoyle and his colleague to develop their steady state view of the universe, a universe that clearly changes because it expands, but one that sort of could stay the same.
Now, the Big Bang Theory did have a flaw, and even George Gamow admitted this. If the Big Bang was very hot, it was an oven. And if it was an oven, it cooked the higher elements. And so all the elements we see around us, carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, should have been cooked in the furnace of the Big Bang. But the data didn't seem to fit. It seemed to explain the abundance of helium quite nicely, but it didn't explain the abundance of the other elements. So how was this flaw eventually resolved?
Yes, it's possible to do quite detailed calculations about the early universe. If you go back to a few minutes after the Big Bang, you know the density of particles, you know the temperature of the Big Bang, and you can work out exactly what cooking should have gone on. And what you can't do is cook the heavy elements, gold, platinum, sodium. They're just too heavy to have been cooked in this short window of what's called nucleosynthesis. And this was an embarrassment for the Big Bang because the Big Bang was supposed to account for everything. Now, ironically, Fred Hoyle, who hated the Big Bang, helped the Big Bang get out of this hole. What Fred Hoyle, working with Willie Fowler and Margaret and Jeffrey Burbidge, together, they wrote an incredible paper called B squared FH, Burbidge, Burbidge, Fowler, and Hoyle, after the names of the authors. In this paper, they explain that if you have different stars of different masses at different points in their lives, at different generations, when those stars collapse, depending on their makeup, they create the heavy elements. And depending on their background, they create different elements. And so it's the collapsing, the death of stars that create the gold, the platinum, the sodium, and everything else. So the story we have now is the Big Bang creates hydrogen and helium and a few other the very light elements. That goes on to form the stars, and then the stars form the rest of the periodic table. And so even though Fred Hoyle was a great critic of the Big Bang, one, he named it, as we said earlier, and two, he helped the Big Bang through the process of stellar death to create all the elements around it.
Now, what finally killed the steady-state theory was the discovery that the afterglow, the shockwave, the echo of the Big Bang is still reverberating throughout the universe, and it could actually be observed experimentally. It was predicted by George Gamow in 1948 with his students, and then found in the 1960s. So explain to us the cosmic microwave background radiation.
Predicted is the key thing here. I think 1948, Gamow, Robert Herman, Ralph Alpha sat down and made a make-or-break prediction. They said if there was a Big Bang, and in 1948 not many people believed in the Big Bang, but they said if there was a Big Bang, it should have been followed by a blast of radiation. What they meant was that in the early universe, all the light, the radiation would have been trapped by sort of scattering off all the charged particles. But after about 400,000 years, those charged particles couple up and form atoms. And suddenly this radiation is released, released to stream throughout the universe. And as the universe is expanding, this radiation would sort of get stretched. And now today we should see that radiation in the form of microwave, the cosmic microwave background radiation, if the Big Bang Theory is true. Look for those microwaves. If you find them, you know the Big Bang Theory is true. If you don't find them, you know the Big Bang Theory is wrong. So make or break test. They were really putting the neck of the Big Bang on the line. And in 1948, nobody could really test this prediction because people didn't have the technology to pick up such microwaves supposedly coming from outer space. But in 1965, Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson, working at Bell Laboratories in New Jersey, had a radio telescope. They were radio astronomers. You pointed up at the sky. You study the radio waves from galaxies, and that way you can work out what's going on inside a galaxy. But even when they didn't point it at a radio galaxy, in fact, when they were trying to calibrate it by pointing it away from a radio galaxy, they still got microwaves. Microwaves are a type of radio wave. They pointed it in a different direction. They still got microwaves. They waited 24 hours. They still got microwaves. Whatever, wherever, whenever they pointed their telescope, they got microwaves. And to start with, they blamed it on a couple of pigeons that were in the telescope. But nothing to do with the pigeons, nothing to do with anything else. Eventually, they realized the microwaves were real. They were coming from the Big Bang. In fact, a cosmologist had to point it out to them and say, look, what you've discovered is the echo from the Big Bang, a kind of luminous echo, an afterglow of creation. The wavelength of these microwaves was exactly what you would expect if it came from the Big Bang. And this is 1965, and it really was a pivotal moment in the history of the Big Bang, because suddenly a lot of people who'd previously been skeptical changed to the other side. So Herman Bondi, who recently passed away, had been a huge supporter of Fred Hoyle, but he'd always said, look, show me one fossil that the Big Bang happened, and I'll believe you. Well, here was a fossil radiation left over from the Big Bang. And in fact, if people tune their radios in between stations and they hear that hissing, crackling sound, 1-2% of the energy that their aerial is picking up is this energy from the Big Bang.
Now, do you find it rather scandalous that George Gamow and his colleagues never won the Nobel Prize for one of the greatest predictions of the last 100 years, and that Fred Hoyle never won the Nobel Prize for nucleosynthesis, even though his colleagues won the Nobel Prize? Do you find that rather scandalous?
Yes, I think Fred Hoyle's case, I think, is particularly sad because, you know, he was wrong about the Big Bang, completely and utterly wrong. But on the other hand, he was incredibly intelligent, a brilliant cosmologist who made great breakthroughs in many areas. And I think he certainly deserved the Nobel Prize for his work with Willie Fowler and the Burbages. Fowler did get the Nobel Prize. Hoyle didn't. And maybe the reason is that Hoyle was very outspoken. He said it how it was. And this often offended people. So when Jocelyn Bell Burnell was overlooked for a Nobel Prize, he openly criticized the Nobel Committee. Later, towards the end of his career, he had some rather crazy ideas. In fact, Hoyle came up with lots of crazy ideas. Some of them turned out to be true. but a lot of them didn't, and those that didn't somehow tarnished his reputation. In terms of Gamow, Alpha, and Hermann not getting a Nobel Prize, I think that's a great shame too. It's one of those limitations of the Nobel that is that only three people get the Nobel Prize. So, you know, you've got five people here. You've got Gamow, Hermann, Alpha, and then you've got Penzias and Wilson. Who gets it? Who doesn't? Who's on the list? Who's off the list? That's a kind of arbitrary decision. Some people say, you know, Wilson and Penzias weren't even looking for the Big Bang. Why should they get the Nobel Prize for making such a lucky discovery? Their discovery was pure serendipity. I think they did deserve credit for their work because many people probably detected that microwave radiation, but they ignored it because it's so gentle, so light, that you can pretty much do your experiment anyway. But Penzias and Wilson refused to just ignore it. They wanted to get to the bottom of it. And so they were really good observational astronomers. And just for their tenacity and determination and attention to detail, as well as their luck, they deserve the Nobel Prize.
Now, earlier we mentioned that Einstein introduced a fudge factor in order to stabilize his universe to account for the Bentley paradox of a collapsing universe if gravity is attractive. But now, perhaps Einstein has the last word, because now the recent data seems to indicate that the universe is expanding out of control and it will eventually die in a big freeze, all because of this cosmological constant, which we now think dominates the entire matter-energy content of the universe, making up 73% of the matter-energy content of the universe. Could you elaborate?
Yes, I think so. Einstein, first of all, didn't have a cosmological constant because his equation was beautiful without it. Then he added it in to stop the universe from collapsing. Then when the Big Bang theory was sort of shown to be right, he threw away the cosmological constant, calling it the biggest blunder of his life. And remember, the cosmological constant seems to repel the universe. It seems to drive it apart, a sort of anti-gravity. And when I was an undergraduate, I was taught that gravity should be pulling the universe back, slowing down the expansion, maybe even causing the universe to collapse. When people tried to measure this in 1998, what they found is that the universe is not slowing down. If anything, it's expanding faster and faster and faster. There seems to be some kind of anti-gravity pushing the universe apart. And that is exactly what Einstein's cosmological constant would do. So first of all, it was out of fashion, then it was in fashion, then it was out of fashion, now it's back in fashion because it seems to explain these anomalous results. And it's a very new discovery, the observation of this accelerating universe. And so cosmologists are still coming to terms with it. But at the moment, it has the label dark energy. And at the moment, the best explanation is that it's the cosmological constant that's causing this runaway expansion.
Well, that concludes our interview with Simon Tseng, a physicist, and he's also a commentator for BBC Television. And let me just add a few things to what he said. He mentioned dark energy, which is one of the greatest secrets of the universe. It's the energy of nothing. That's right. Even nothingness has energy associated with it. And it's anti-gravitational. It's repulsive. It's pushing the galaxies apart. And as he mentioned, that's giving us the Big Bang. So when you learn about the Big Bang theory, the first question that comes to mind is, why? Why is the universe expanding? And the reason is that it contains a repulsive force, dark energy. It is the energy of the vacuum. So the more vacuum there is, the more dark energy there is, and the greater the expansion. So as big as the universe is, it gets bigger because it feeds on the energy of nothing, which is anti-gravitational. So the more you have, the more you can get. And that, by definition, is an exponential curve. Now, if you ever figure out what dark matter and dark energy are, tell me first, and we'll split the Nobel Prize together, you and me, because These are some of the greatest mysteries of the universe. We now realize that you and me and the atoms of carbon and oxygen and nitrogen, the familiar elements of our body, only represent like 0.01% of the universe. We are the oddballs. Most of the universe is made out of dark energy, about 73%, roughly speaking, is made out of dark energy. 23% is made out of dark matter, invisible matter which holds the galaxy together. The stars are made of hydrogen and helium. They make up about 4% of the universe. But what about you and me? What about carbon and oxygen and hydrogen? We represent something like 0.01% of the universe. In other words, we're made out of nuclear waste. We're made out of the waste created by the burning of stars. Most of the universe is dark. And unfortunately, we're clueless as to understanding what they are. Now, according to Einstein's theory, dark energy could be a term in his equations which give us the energy of nothing. But where did it come from? If you try to calculate the amount of dark energy in the universe, you're off by 10 to the 100 or so. That's one with 100 zeros after it. That is the greatest mismatch in the history of science. Who would have thought that we would be 10 to the 100 times off when we try to calculate dark energy from first principles? And so, like I said, if you want to win a Nobel Prize in physics, if you want to go down in history like the giants of history, like Einstein, then find out what dark energy and dark matter are. That's the challenge. Well, I'm afraid that's it for exploration. And if you want to find out more about my work, go to my website, mkaku.org, mkaku.org, and find out about the New York Times bestsellers that I've written and the research I do concerning dark energy, dark matter, and the creation of the universe. So this is Dr. Michio Kaku for Exploration.